Out of all of the pests in the garden, I think my least favorite pest of all is the cabbage worm. The reason being is that the cabbage worms can be extremely tiny and hard to see at first, and then all of a sudden they have taken over your plant. Today we're going to talk about the different types of cabbage worms, how to identify the damage, what to do about it, and how to prevent them. We live in South Central Pennsylvania, and the two most prevalent types of cabbage worms in our area are the imported cabbage worm and the cross-striped cabbage worm. You may have also heard of cabbage loopers, but I personally have not dealt with them, so I'm not going to focus on them. So for the imported cabbage worm, they are green in color. The color of the moth that lays the eggs for the cabbage worms is a white color, and they have black spots on their back. You probably have seen these flying around during the day, and they are not your friend. They are actually your enemy, especially if you have brassica plants. Cabbage worms primarily feed on brassica plants, so that is your cabbage, broccoli, kale, cauliflower, kohlrabi, anything that is within that family is what those cabbage worms will like to feed on. For the cross-striped cabbage worm, they have stripes on them, and they look a lot different than the imported cabbage worm. The moth that lays those eggs is a gray moth. I haven't done a ton of research on when that moth is active because they aren't my biggest threat. My biggest threat is the imported cabbage worm. Once the moths lay the eggs on the plant, they are extremely hard to see. They're very, very tiny, and those eggs will hatch anywhere between 4 to 10 days. So if you've watched some of my other videos, you will see that I will try to find eggs to get rid of pests, but that is just not an option with cabbage worms. So here's an example of what the eggs look like. There's one right here, and there's one up there in that corner. They are a very, very light green, almost yellow color, but they are really hard to see. If you're not familiar with what they look like, you would never notice them. But what I wanted to show you here is that this is kind of what a plant might look like if it just has a beginning level of damage from some type of cabbage worm. So this, you can tell this leaf has had more damage than something like up here. They have a tendency to feed on the outer leaves first and then move towards the middle of the plant. From what I've noticed, they definitely prefer certain plants over other plants. This is one of my broccoli plants. I have harvested most of my broccoli. This is just one of them that's left. I will probably harvest this little head of broccoli and then pull this out. If you see cabbage worm damage on your broccoli plants when you go to harvest, there's a good chance that there are some worms up in the florets themselves. What I do is I rinse the florets in warm water with salt in it. This causes the worms to relax their bodies and let go of the broccoli. Now, I found that this doesn't get rid of 100% of them, so if you have a large infestation, I probably would just throw it in the compost bin or give it to the chickens. Here's an example of more intense damage from a cabbage worm. I'm going to go up to my chicken garden and show you drastic damage from a cabbage worm, but this plant is pretty much done for. So at this point, I'm going to rip this out and give it to the chickens. But I just wanted to leave it in here so that I could show you guys what the damage looks like and how it progresses over time. I even have a cauliflower head down in here, and there's a cabbage worm on top of it. Before we go up to the chicken garden and I show you how cabbage worms have decimated my plants up there, I wanted to show you the difference between two of my cabbage plants and how my succession planting affected the damage done by the cabbage worm. So with succession planting, you will plant some of your plants out sooner than another grouping of plants. When I did this with my cabbage, some of the cabbage was able to get large enough and to be more resistant to the cabbage worms than some of the younger, more tender plants. It's really interesting to watch how those cabbage worms know that and they attack the younger plants, and they kind of left those more mature plants alone, and I was able to get several harvests from my cabbage. So here is an example of a cabbage plant that I planted out earlier than the one that I'm going to show you next. You can see there's damage on the outer leaves from the cabbage worms, but not on the cabbage itself. I'm going to harvest this today. We'll have some more cabbage from the garden, but let's go ahead and look at these other younger plants. Now these, I think I might have planted these 3 or 4 weeks later, and you can see that not only is the damage on these outer leaves, but it is heavily fed upon on the cabbage itself. This particular cabbage isn't very large, so I will probably pull this up and give it to the chickens. They will absolutely love that. Now this one also has a ton of damage. You can see it even from this far away. The cabbage itself looks pretty big. I'm not sure if I can pull off some outer leaves and still harvest the core here, but there's some pretty deep holes in there. I'm not sure. I'll have to evaluate it, pull this up and see what I get. All right, welcome to my cauliflower and kale graveyard. All of my plants are absolutely skeletons up here. The intent for this garden was to give this stuff to the chickens, but unfortunately, I don't really have much to give them. I will be able to give them what's left, but the reason why I left these plants up here is because I have some beneficial insects around here and I didn't want to ruin their habitat. So I will talk about that in a little bit. If you notice that you have cabbage worm damage and it is at the early stages, then you still have time to address the issue. What I recommend doing is using what is called BT. BT is a bacteria that the caterpillar will ingest and then it attacks their gut and then they eventually die. When you use the BT, what you'll do is you'll mix it with water per the instructions and you'll put it in a spray bottle. With the spray bottle, you will spray the top side and the bottom side of all of the leaves on the plant, and then it will slowly kill the caterpillars. They won't die overnight, but they will eventually die. The only thing I don't like about this is that it's super time intensive, so I try not to spray unless I absolutely have to. Once the mixture is made, you're supposed to use it within 12 hours, so keep that in mind when you're mixing so that you don't mix too much. I personally do not spray things like kale and lettuce ever. That's just a personal preference for me, because if I'm going to eat that, I don't want to ingest any sort of bacteria or anything. So I personally don't do that. I know a lot of people do. There's nothing wrong with it. That's just my personal opinion. Now, as far as this garden here, we have been traveling. We have been so busy. So I kind of just let this go and have been focusing on my main garden. I mentioned a little bit earlier that I left this as is because I noticed beneficial insects. So we are going to talk about that next. There are a couple of things that will attack caterpillars that I've noticed in my personal garden. One of those being a parasitic wasp. So what happens with the parasitic wasps is that they lay eggs on the caterpillar or near the caterpillar, and they use the caterpillar as a host for those eggs. I've seen tons of parasitic wasp eggs all over these plants, so I am leaving them here in hopes that they increase in population and help me out next year. I also have noticed what's called an assassin bug crawling around in this area. I've seen several of them, and I've seen them and watched them attack the actual caterpillars, so I know they're helping in my favor. So I'm kind of leaving these, waiting for those eggs to hatch, and then I'll pull them up and either put them in the compost bin or give them to the chickens. The best thing that you can do with cabbage worms is to work to prevent them. The first thing that you can do is you can change your planting schedule so that you're planting those plants out earlier. I'm in the zone 6A/7B, so I planted some of my broccoli and cabbage as early as the first week of March, and I was able to get a harvest before the cabbage worms were even active. Now, that's gonna change depending on where you live, but changing your planting season will definitely help. The second thing that you can do, The second thing that you can do is you can put a row cover over your crops. This will prevent the moths from being able to lay eggs in the first place. This is something that I have not personally tried, but I plan to do next year. Especially for the things that I don't get out as early as I want to, I'm going to use a cover crop to prevent eggs from being laid. The last thing that I want to share with you is a method that I tried this year that did not work and was an absolute failure, but a learning experience. So professionally, outside of the YouTube world, I am an engineer and I study engineering in school, and we always are taught to look for the root cause of an issue. So for me, the moth is considered to be the root cause of this issue that I have. So I started doing a bunch of research on the imported cabbage worm moth. I don't know what the actual moth itself is called, but I did a bunch of research on it and I found out that they are very territorial moths. And what I ended up stumbling upon was a Reddit thread where people were talking about using decoys to get rid of the cabbage moths. So if you see behind me, I think you can see a fluttering, what looks to be a moth in the background. That is not a moth, that is a piece of paper that I used packaging tape to kind of act as like a laminate, and then I tied it to a post. So I'll pull one out of the ground for you so you can see it. But essentially, this is what I did. And they flutter in the wind and they do look like moths. I thought that it was working at first, but clearly it is not. So maybe it's worth a try where you're at. Print out some images that look like the white moths, tape them up, and then tie them to a post and see how it goes. It might be worth it. For me, I thought it was working at the beginning, but didn't end up working. So thought I would share that with you as well. Thank you so much for watching. I hope that you learned something from this video. Make sure to click the thumbs up if you liked it. Leave a comment below and let me know what you do to get rid of your cabbage worms. I'm always super curious to learn what other gardeners are doing and what works for them. Make sure to subscribe to our channel to follow more gardening content and also to see our house build journey. So if you're not familiar, Alex and I are building our own home on 6 acres nearby to the current farm that we're living on. This farm is Alex's mom, so we live here with her now. We help her manage it. She lets us do some of our own projects, and we are eventually going to be moving. So definitely subscribe for that journey because it's just going to be a crazy learning experience, and we're gonna share the ups and downs along the way. Thanks again. I can't believe I was able to get such great footage of the assassin bug attacking a caterpillar. This is literally something that you would see on planet Earth, so I'm super excited that I was able to capture this on camera.